Einstein was right, man. Time is totally relative. It is not a fixed unit of measurement, I'm sure of it. Hey, thank you for all the prayers for my mother-in-law. I told you it was a week ago. I think today she was hit by a car in a really bad accident while she was walking in the street, and it basically destroyed her left leg. She's coming home today from the hospital and the facility, so I was just on the phone with Paula during the break. So she's doing a lot better. I appreciate that. So thank you all. I'll get to some of your calls coming up. You're just such really caring people on a very serious note. You're just wonderful people. I can sense it in the way you write your emails and your messages to me, that you didn't just, like, it wasn't some, like, form thing you put together. So thank you. It means a lot. Are the Biden administration's New Year's goals of taxing and spending and turning a blind eye to inflation at odds with your goals of securing your savings? Of course they are. When you've had enough of the games government's playing with your savings and retirement, diversify into gold with Birch Gold, B-I-R-C-H. That's why I buy gold. I bought it from Birch multiple times. For over 5,000 years, gold has withstood inflation, geopolitical turmoil, and stock market crashes. Here's the good news here. You can still get it. In fact, you can own gold and silver in a tax-sheltered retirement account. Birch Gold makes it easy to convert an IRA or 401k into an IRA in precious metals. Here's what you need to do. Text Bongino to 989898 to claim your free information kit on gold, and then talk to one of their precious metal specialists. They'll hold your hand through the whole process. With an A-plus rating with the Better Business Bureau, thousands of happy customers, me included, and countless five-star reviews, Birch Gold is who I trust to protect my future and yours. Text Bongino, B-O-N-G-I-N-O, to 989898 today. Past performance is not a guarantee of future results. Message and data rates apply.
Dan Bongino. You're listening to Dan Bongino on News Talk STL at 101.9, 94.1 and NewsTalkSTL.com.
All right, let's go to the phones. Let's take Justin. Justin, you're on the Dan Bongino show. What do you got for us?
Hey, thanks, Dan. Awesome shows this week. I've got a very important. We know that the FBI has had the Hunter Biden laptop since 2019, but what we've never heard and never has been confirmed is that they have actually investigated what is in the laptop. I say deliberately on purpose, because they know it would have prevented the Joe Biden administration. They know there's crimes on there. They've sat on it. It's the Biden Protection Program and the destruction of Justice Department. Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, wow. That was kind of, yeah. I agree that the FBI deliberately sat on it. That was interesting. Thanks, Justin. Great call, though. Appreciate how you just kind of got right to the point. Let's say Ken. Ken, you're on the Dan Bongino show. What do you got for us?
Well, I want to say thanks for sharing the facts regarding the COVID jab with your audience. Facts, yes, sir, that I've been hearing from my doctor's office since the beginning. And Dan, now, I realize Donald Trump was misled when he was told about the vaccine and when he was told about the jab. That's why he promoted it. But, Dan, I really think that we need to reach out to Donald Trump, and I'm sure he's listening to your show today, and get him to stop supporting the vaccine with all the facts that we now know. I like Donald Trump. Yeah. I voted for him twice, Dan. But he still supports, he still promotes the vaccines.
And, I'm so sorry. Listen, the show's ending, but I agree with you. I've said as much to people surrounding him as well. It's time to move on. I agree with you 100%. You don't have to convince me, brother. I am with you. It's definitely time to move on. I'll see you back here tomorrow, folks.
Message. Life insurance is one of those things that just about everybody needs, but few people actually have. Hey, if you die unexpectedly without life insurance, guess what? You'll leave your family with even a bigger mess. Life insurance will help replace your family's income. It'll help cover burial expenses. Life insurance can even help pay off debt like credit cards and medical bills. Life insurance can even pay for college. And if you own a business and you die, life insurance can help your business from collapsing. It can even help cover estate taxes. Life insurance has never been more affordable and needed. Plus, you can always shop around even if you have a plan and save some money. So call the Life Insurance Quote Line right now for free pricing information.
800-979-3060. 800-979-3060. 800-979-3060. That's 800-979-3060.
The future depends on teachers. Every day, teachers are shaping our tomorrows, starting their students on journeys that will change the course of history.
Right now, in a classroom somewhere in the United States, there's a teacher inspiring a future scientist who'll make preventing pandemics their life's work, sharpening the mind of an aspiring environmentalist who'll help combat climate change,
and generating possibilities for a student who'll become the first in their family to graduate college.
It all starts with teachers who meet challenges with creativity, who reinvent education for the future, who work towards a school system that lifts up every child, regardless of race, income, or zip code, and who enable the full potential of our students, our communities, and our country.
Explore a career that leaves a legacy you can be proud of. Shape the future. Teach.
KLGY HD3 Clay, K270BW Bellefonte, KNBS Bowling Green.
This is News Talk STL at 101.9, 94.1, and always streaming at newstalkstl.com.
Breaking news this hour from townhall.com. I'm John Scott. Five fired Memphis police officers charged with second-degree murder and other crimes in the arrest and death of Tyree Nichols, a black motorist who died 3 days after a confrontation with the officers during a traffic stop. Police video showed Nichols, a 29-year-old FedEx worker and father, was shot, pepper sprayed, and restrained when he was pulled over for a traffic stop near his home. An opponent of former President Trump enters the California Senate race. More from correspondent Bernie Bennett.
California Democrat Congressman Adam Schiff officially launched his bid for the U.S. Senate Thursday, making him the second entrant in the Democratic battle to potentially replace Senator Dianne Feinstein. Schiff's announcement follows fellow Democrat Katie Porter jumping into the race earlier this month. Feinstein has not said whether she'll run for a sixth term in office, but she's widely expected to retire at the end of her current term. Other California Democrats, including Representatives Barbara Lee and Ro Khanna, are also said to be plotting potential runs for the Senate. Bernie Bennett, Washington.
Also at townhall.com, the 25-year-old school teacher in Newport News, Virginia, who was shot and wounded by a 6-year-old student, plans to sue the school district. Her lawyer, Diane Toscano, accuses administrators of failing to act after they warned that the boy had a gun.
The administrator downplayed the report from the teacher and the possibility of a gun, saying, and I quote, "Well, he has little pockets." This is outrageous.
Last night, the school board voted to fire its district superintendent. He's been sharply criticized by parents and teachers since the January 6th shooting. On Wall Street, stocks remain higher. The Dow is up 130 points. The NASDAQ adding 149. More at townhall.com.
We're entering a time of increasing hostility against people of faith, a time when Christians are going to be tested on a moral and physical and financial basis, unlike any other time in our lifetime. I'm Lance Wall, now Christian author, evangelical leader, here to remind you that you have to take action to protect and steward what God has given you. For example, record high inflation is going to continue to eat away at the dollar, and the savings of your retirement account is in danger. Fortunately, God does provide a way. To protect your retirement, I recommend diversifying your 401k or IRA out of paper and into physical gold. And the best way to do that is with a gold IRA from Birch Gold Group. Now, to see how it works, just text the word FAITH to 989898. That'll give you access to a free info kit on gold IRAs. There are no strings attached, so text FAITH, F-A-I-T-H, to 989898 right now, and I pray your family is blessed with peace of mind because you took action.
From the News Talk STL Newsroom, I'm Joey Vasevich. Ferguson's mayor confirmed on Wednesday that the city officially accepted the resignation of city manager Eric Osterberg. Fire Chief John Hampton will serve as interim city manager. Back in September, Osterberg announced his resignation and then retracted it days later, saying he was there to stay as long as some council members stopped interfering with him doing his job. The St. Louis Convention and Visitors Commission has brought back 7 positions it cut during the height of the coronavirus pandemic due to them relying on hotel taxes for a portion of its revenue. The commission restored its group sales coordinator, leisure travel sales coordinator, Meet St. Louis manager, 2 event managers, and 2 maintenance positions. In honor of this Friday being International Holocaust Remembrance Day, the St. Louis Kaplan Feldman Holocaust Museum has a slate of activities planned for this weekend. The 27th through the 29th are pay-as-you-wish days. All tickets purchased during the weekend must be purchased in person, and online ticket sales will be unavailable. In what's considered to be the Oscars of food, the James Beard Foundation just released its list of semifinalists, and several St. Louis chefs are named. A few of the nominees on the Best Chef Midwest list include those from Balkan Treat Box, Bullrush, and Indo. The final awards will be announced on June 5th. And in sports, the Blues are in Arizona tonight to face the Coyotes. Puck drop is at 8 p.m. For in-depth coverage of these stories and more, go to NewsTalkSTL.com.
From the Michaels Flooring Outlet Weather Center.
I'm News 4 meteorologist Kristen Cornett with your first alert forecast. Sky's becoming mostly sunny this afternoon with a high of 31, but with winds out of the west gusting as high as 20 miles per hour, wind chills will range between 15 and 20 degrees. Tonight, mostly clear as we drop to 23, and then on Friday, partly to mostly cloudy, a breezy day, wind gust to 30 miles per hour, but warmer. The afternoon high, 48 degrees.
This hour of News Talk STL brought to you by The Dental Link. Call Dr. Alan Link today, 314-794-6464, to schedule your free consultation. Offices in Baldwin and Melville, 314-794-6464.
Tony Colombo.
Libertarianism is all about individual liberty.
Katie Fitzpatrick.
Oh, good for you.
Colombo and Katie on News Talk STL.
Time to rise as many.
Colombo and Katie on 101.9 and 94.1 News Talk STL. I am Tony Colombo. Of course, my partner is Katie Fitzpatrick, and we are with you on what looks to be a very nice Thursday, right? Thursday afternoon out there.
Yes, sir.
Look at the blue skies.
It's gorgeous. It's a beauty out there.
It's above freezing, so...
We had snow yesterday.
Yeah.
And this is what's today.
A little bit of snow.
Yeah, a little bit. But still, snow.
Just a little bit of snow.
And now it's in the 40s. Just gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous.
Absolutely gorgeous. And yeah, and it is above freezing out there. So all of that snow, the little bit that was out there, is all melting away. And
that's what's happening.
Blue skies and moderately warm.
It's St. Louis.
Like, comparatively warm. Over the next few days, because that's how we be rolling in
Missouri. That is how we roll. It is like every single day is a guessing game. 1 minute sleet, next day snow, next day sunny. You gotta love it.
Mm-hmm. So a lot to talk about today, and we will be getting into all of that throughout the entire next hour here on Colombo and Katie, and then. And just after 3 o'clock, just about an hour from now, we will talk to our friend JT, Jason Thornton, the host of Pocket Watching with JT, which you can hear every Friday night at 8 o'clock here on News Talk STL, and get our weekly dose of common sense financial advice, because that is what JT does, not only on his show every week, but in his personal life. JT is a certified financial planner, and so he's not just somebody who is kind of smart in that area. He actually makes a living and is professional in that industry, so he definitely knows what he's talking about, and we always say that, every time that JT is on with us, or every time you tune into an episode of Pocket Watching, you will pick up some good advice to just live your financial life in a little bit healthier
better, absolutely, more productive way. So definitely looking forward to talking to JT here in just a little bit. Lots of stories to dive into. This one, the one I want to start with, I think, is just is kind of funny, but it's kind of scary also.
Oh, no.
But it's definitely not like typically a top of the news headline type story, but I think it really paints a picture of, you know, some of the things that go on behind the scenes in Washington, D.C. and across our... Oh, speaking of Washington, D.C., if you're wondering why we're not talking to Christian Daytalk today, I'm glad I was thinking about the Capitol here, because we were promoting earlier that we were going to talk to Christian like we do usually on Thursdays today around 2:20, 2:25. He is busy at the White House. He is, of course, part of that the press corps there at the White House with the Washington Examiner, and he is unable to join us this afternoon, so... Christian Daytalk will be with us tomorrow afternoon, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
So so Christian will be with us tomorrow instead of today. So we will still talk to Christian this week, but it won't be this afternoon. But anyway, this story, I think, shines some light on, you know, the kind of people that are in charge of upholding the justice system across this country. And, you know, whenever there's a Supreme Court justice or, you know, a high level a judge being appointed or going through appointment hearings, you know, that makes national news. But there's so many judges across the country that obviously, you know, unless it's like the Supreme Court, we don't really hear about these people. This story is absolutely fascinating to me. A Biden judicial nominee was unable to answer basic questions about the United States Constitution posed by Senator John Kennedy during a Senate hearing yesterday afternoon. This judge, her name is Charmel. I'm going to say it is Jelkengren.
That's a last name.
Well, here's the spelling. B J E L K E N G R E N.
That's not a last name. I don't know what you just listed off the alphabet. I have no idea what.
I am going to guess that that's some kind of like Slovakian type thing.
Cow.
And I'm going to guess, just because of the way it's written, that the B is silent. The first letter is silent. And her name is Charmel Jelkengren. But anyway. She is a judge that is that's been appointed by Joe Biden, and can't answer questions about the basic questions about the United States Constitution. So, this judge of Spokane County Superior Court in Washington State was nominated by President Biden to serve on the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of Washington. During her confirmation hearing before the Senate Judiciary Committee, the judge, I'm just going to say the judge instead of trying to say that last name every time, the judge could not answer Kennedy's questions about what different parts of the U.S. Constitution do and how courts might interpret laws. Quote, "Tell me what Article 5 of the Constitution does," Kennedy instructed the judge at the beginning of his question time. "Article 5 is not coming to mind at the moment," the judge said. "Okay, how about Article 2? Kennedy followed up with. The judge again said that she was unable to recall Article 2. "Article 5, just so you know, Article 5 of the Constitution concerns the amendments process, and Article 2 invests the executive power in the President of the United States, enumerating the powers of the executive branch." So next, Kennedy asked the judge if the judge knew what purposivism is, but she was again unable to answer the question. Purposivism, or the purposive approach. See, I don't know these things, but I'm not a judge. I'm not supposed to know these things. I know radio. I don't know the judge stuff, but a judge should know judge stuff. Anyway, this is the philosophy of interpreting the law that emphasizes the law's purpose, advocating for judges to enforce the spirit of the law when it contradicts with the text of the law. So all of these questions that, again, are basic questions for somebody in the law.
Yeah, who studied that?
Yeah. If you and I don't completely understand all of those questions, that's a different story. We are not being nominated to the U.S. District Court.
I think in like the simplest way, too, whenever I hear stories like this, I always picture myself going into an office with you and Jeff Allen and saying, I'd like a job at News Talk STL. And you guys saying, okay, let's go over your qualifications. Do you know about this? Do you know about that? And if I simply say, no, I don't know how to work a board. I don't know how to cut up audio. I've never timed anything out a day in my life. In fact, I don't know how to tell time.
Yeah.
I think you guys are going to say, we need someone better to do the job.
Yeah. I want a job at News Talk STL. Okay, what do we do here? I don't know what you do here. Maybe...
It seems like a very simple thing. If you looked at your day today, would you be able to get a job that you have right now if you could not answer the most basic questions of how your job functions? And what's scary is that we're talking about people that execute the law. We're talking about people that help make a decision that changes people's lives for the better or for the worse, that implement the law throughout our land. So when we look at a judge, they get to say an order declared because they looked at a law.
So
that scares me.
My question is, how is this person getting such a high nomination by the president of the United States? Because if they can't answer what seem to be basic questions that a judge at that level should be able to answer. Is there another reason? Are there other political reasons, maybe, that that person is being nominated to that position?
Absolutely.
Because,
absolutely.
And how often does that happen? And how many? I mean, it's kind of like we've talked a lot about how when we were kids, you looked at senators and congresspeople as like the smartest of the smart. And oh man, you can't be in the United States House of Representatives unless you are just, really at the top of your class and one of the smartest people in the world. You think that as a kid. And then you realize, oh boy, there's some actually really dumb people that find their way into the United States Senate and the United States House and other high ranking pieces of government. This kind of reminds me of that because it's like you just assume that a judge at that level must be an expert.
Yes.
At all things in the law.
I would hope
because
so.
Because they should be.
I would.
But how often does this type of thing happen where somebody's at that level maybe for different reasons? And maybe she just had a bad day. I don't know anything about this judge. But it just does. But I find it hard to believe that it would just be a bad day situation for somebody who is being nominated to such a high position that can't answer
basic questions
about the Constitution.
What makes me
purpose of a vision? Okay, I'll give you a pass.
I'll give you
on
that one.
But unless it's a very common term, maybe Tim Jones or Nick Schroer or somebody who's an attorney would know. But
what makes me nervous is that this administration is notorious for hiring people that check out the boxes.
That's exactly right.
So is this a box filler or is this someone that is adequate to be a judge that can fulfill that role and do it successfully? My notion and what scares me when I look at this administration or just the progression of what we do as a country. We have lawmakers, Congress people who their job is to make the law. Then we have the judicial branch, which is enforcing the law. I think I said execute earlier. Enforcing that law that was being made. Two very important roles in our government. And if we're solely hiring these people and voting for these people based off of the checking of boxes that are irrelevant to their qualifications of doing these jobs, then what are we doing how are we moving forward as a country with any legislation?
Mm-hmm.
How are we moving forward making laws, enforcing laws, creating laws? None of that makes any sense to me if all we're doing is saying, here's a woman, that's her qualification.
Yeah.
Here's an Asian dude, that's his qualification.
Yeah. Yeah.
That doesn't. What does that do to the country, to us as a society?
We have to have, Well, because of the color of their skin, we will promote them up because we have to, you know, like you said, check certain boxes or, you know, fill certain criteria. I don't know. That doesn't sound that putting somebody in a position because of the color of their skin. That sounds like racism to me.
I think it is.
I think racism, we need to get away from it. So it just doesn't seem like these are the people that are fighting for equality, but they very often fight for things that are not, that don't serve the purpose of equality.
And I whenever we're talking about something like this too, and we're saying we should definitely obviously be moving away from racism.
And maybe this judge isn't checking any boxes. Maybe it's a different reason that she's there, but it doesn't seem like she's qualified for the position, which means there's some reason out there that she's being nominated.
And what is it? I guess that's what these hearings are for. Yeah. It's like, well, what is it then?
Yeah. Why is the president nominating this person that can't answer questions, basic questions about the United States Constitution?
Scary.
Yeah, it is. All right, we've got a lot of stories to get to today. You know, the whole Kevin McCarthy situation with Eric Swalwell and Adam Schiff. Well, Eric Swalwell has released a cryptic threat.
Huh? Is he threatening?
He's going to get him. Okay. For that, Adam Schiff has made a big announcement today that is in the wake of that story. As well, there's been an announcement made by Florida Senator Rick Scott regarding the 2024 presidential election and many, many other things happening. We will get into all of those as we go through the afternoon here. Don't go anywhere. You are listening to Colombo and Katie on 101.9 and 94.1 News Talk STL.
Like us on Facebook at News Talk STL. Subscribe and watch your favorite News Talk STL shows.
Mike Ferguson in the Morning.
The Vic Porcelli Show.
Colombo and Katie.
Jones and Arps.
Webcam streaming on Facebook, Twitter, Rumble.
Subscribe and watch
News Talk STL.
If you need to raise big money fast, you can do so with a TJ's Pizza fundraiser. There's no better way to raise money for an organization that you belong to, like a school or a church, or maybe your kids are on a sports team or belong to a dance club or a gymnastics team. I don't know why I would make that comparison. And you need to raise money for equipment or for travel or for uniforms, whatever it may be. Again, no better way to do so than with a TJ's Pizza fundraiser. TJ's Pizza Fundraising has been in the St. Louis area, has been the number one fundraising company in the St. Louis area for over 30 years. In that time, they have raised tens of millions of dollars for their customers. That is not hyperbole. That is the truth. Tens of millions of dollars for their customers. And they have also learned over those decades to get better at the fundraising game. They don't just rest on their laurels and just hope that name recognition takes them, you know, gets them all the extra business or holds on to business. They learn from all those years of talking to their customers. You know, how can we make this an easier process? How can we make this better for you? How can we meet your time deadlines? How can we make sure that we are always meeting your monetary guidelines for your fundraising? And they apply that, and they create different systems like the pop-up fundraiser and digital online fundraising and other things that you can take advantage of when you conduct a TJ's Pizza fundraiser. Of course, the customer service is fantastic, especially if it's your first fundraiser or your first in a very long time. They'll help you every step of the way to make sure you are achieving your goals. They have huge profit margins, and also they have great products. That is the number one reason that TJ's Pizza stands above the rest, because TJ's Pizza are delicious and people want them and they want to buy them from you, and it's just a great way to raise money. And of course, all the other products, the pies and the cookies and the cookie dough and everything else, just great products to help you with your fundraising efforts. So if you are ready to raise big money now, get started at tjspizza.com.
News Talk STL is proud to have Doug Voss of Safe Money Radio as part of our lineup each week. Doug has been a staple on St. Louis Radio for many years as one of the leading financial experts in the area. Doug and Safe Money Radio is on three times every weekend, but in case you miss anything, you can check it all out at DougVossSafeMoneyRadio.com or call 844-676-SAFE. That's 844-676-7233. Doug Voss is a registered representative. Securities offered through DHL Securities, LLLP. Member FINRA and SIPC.
Mike Ferguson in the morning.
I've had two vaccines, and then I had issues with my legs. I'm standing today, but for a long time, I had to sit.
You had to sit, yeah.
I don't know if it had anything to do with it, but it was around the time I had it done.
Ken's very shy, but he doesn't want to tell people they actually had to have a procedure after getting the vaccine to remove a tail.
Yeah, well, I didn't want to divulge that, Mike. No. Thank you.
The pictures were awful.
Yeah, really? You're not going to give those out, are you?
No.
Weekday mornings, 5:30 to 9 on News Talk STL.
Are you the type of person who loves their community and wants it to be the best it can be? Now it's easier than ever to do your part. Go to recyclemo.com to see just how easy it is to recycle the right way. Or, if you already recycle and want to be as efficient as possible, recyclemo.com can tell you what should and should not be recycled in your area. Become part of the clean recycling movement today. It's the right thing to do. Sponsored by the Missouri Department of Natural Resources.
Tim Jones and Chris Arps in the afternoon.
It's Thursday, and at 4:05, Todd Graves, chairman of the Herzog Foundation, and at 4:25, Jim Carafano from the Heritage Foundation.
Tim Jones and Chris Arps. Weekdays at 3:30 on News Talk STL. Follow us on Rumble at News Talk STL.
Little Midwest Avengers there.
Sure is.
Nice. That's great stuff. Support local music every chance you get. Welcome back to Colombo and Katie on 101.9 and 94.1 News Talk STL. Just diving into some of the headlines of the day here. I mentioned this one yesterday, and we didn't get to the story. I teased it and then didn't get to it, and I feel bad about that, so we're getting into it now. At a mayoral debate in Chicago just a couple of days ago, Lori Lightfoot, the current mayor, of course, of Chicago, says a way to stop crime, specifically how to prevent muggings in the city of Chicago, is for the citizens of Chicago to just stop carrying cash. I mentioned this yesterday as the Democrats, another way to blame regular, everyday, law-abiding citizens for the crime that's happening in their area rather than targeting the criminals. Just stop carrying cash and you'll stop getting mugged.
That is the laziest thing I have ever heard in my life as a mayor.
The crime. They wanted, you know, it's just like saying, it's just like in Illinois, speaking of Chicago, it's just like in Illinois, how they say, oh, we're going to stop gun violence by making it impossible for law-abiding gun owners to buy certain types of guns and certain types of magazine. No, you're penalizing the law-abiding citizen. You think that because you can't go buy an AR in the state of Illinois that that's
going to
stop
gonna
a criminal from using an AR during a crime in the state of Illinois? Of course not. But it's going to make it a whole lot harder for the person that is a hunter or just wants to buy an AR to defend their home or just for sport likes to shoot. It's that same exact mindset of punishing the law-abiding everyday citizen instead of focusing on the crime. She said that on the debate stage. They asked her, how do you stop with the crime issue in the city of Chicago, specifically when it comes to muggings on the streets? Mm-hmm. What is something that you can do? And her answer was to tell people to stop carrying cash so there's nothing to steal. It's just like the idea of, like, we've heard police even in this area say, you know, if you're parked, if your car is in a bad neighborhood or something, don't lock the doors. Just leave the doors open, because then if somebody wants to come steal from you, they won't bash your window open.
It's at least so they can stupid. Open it's the so
door.
Lazy.
Like, don't leave anything in your car worth stealing. And let them open the door and go through your stuff. And then that way they're not breaking the window. Just leave your door unlocked. That's literally been something that we've heard before. Like, why is it on the law-abiding citizens to... Now, there is, sure, giving advice, like... You know, giving advice to people that is common sense, good advice to help keep yourself safe, that's totally understandable, should be done in one thing. But to basically make that the answer to crime, we'll stop muggings by telling people to stop carrying cash.
Well, this is one part lazy. One part is lazy of people being like,
very lazy.
Oops, we give up.
We give
There's
up.
No more solutions.
It's a full give up.
Yep. It's a free for all. You know what? It's actually better. Let's hold the legal, law-abiding citizens accountable for their things instead of, as you just said, holding the criminals accountable for their actions. But the second part about this is, and it's funny that you bring this up because Vic and I just had this conversation this morning. We are entering a time in our lives and in society where we are creating a habit of people becoming vigilantes. And when I say that, I mean, even law-abiding people are starting to say, I'm going to take matters into my own hands again. And even though it's not legal to do that, I'm going to do it because I need to protect myself and I need to protect my belongings and the things and the people I care about. So because we have these lazy mayors, because we have these lazy laws, and because we've also, another factor to this, have totally said to police officers, whatever you do, you are going to be the person that's in trouble. So you can't do your job anymore. You can't protect people and you're under a microscope. All of those things have a part to play in people being vigilantes. And what's sad is that whether it be justified or unjust, none of that matters because being a vigilante is illegal. But dangerous if you let that become the norm. But when you're a mayor and you're saying, you're on your own, bud.
Yep.
You're getting mugged and that's on you.
Yeah.
What do you think that citizen is going to do?
Absolutely.
And that's the society that we're living in. We're not... And Vic and I, it's so crazy how everybody, like, at the station, somehow we all function in one brain. Like, things just get, like, teleported to each other through thought. But that's exactly the fear that's happening in St. Louis. I mean, what in the world, why in the world would anybody feel safe or protected in their own communities anymore when they're trying to take away our guns? And that's not like a conservative, like, that's real.
Yeah.
And when they're telling you, if your key is stolen, I don't know what to tell you.
When you're relying on Kim Gardner to deliver justice, you feel pretty helpless.
You do. And you take matters in your own hands.
Kim Gardner story coming up here in a few minutes that addresses that exact thing. But you're exactly right. When you have a mayor telling you that she's not going to do anything about the crime, and I'm talking about Lori Lightfoot again, when she's not going to do anything about the crime and just tells you to stop carrying cash, or like Biden, you know, Biden's answer to energy and climate problems. Remember, it was in the summer. It was, well, just don't set your air conditioner any lower than 75. So how about you fix the problem instead of making it our problem, or that? Don't lock your doors so people don't have to break it. So criminals don't have to break your window to get in the car. Just make sure you don't have anything in there worth stealing and let them open the door and go through your stuff.
I mean,
like, that is when you create that feeling of helplessness, like, these people are not helping me. The people that are supposed to be the leaders, and this very rarely is the everyday police officer, who are usually overworked, underpaid, and, you know, have...
you know, lots of problems, lots of things to deal with.
Have 12-hour shifts because there's not enough
people.
Mm-hmm. So it's usually the people like Lori Lightfoot or Kimberly Gardner that are, you know, the leaders that are responsible for this type of thing that are not doing their jobs that make people feel helpless, make people feel like there's nobody that is fighting for their own justice. And that, to your point, just creates the motivation to try to dish out some vigilante justice. And as much as that can sound cool and righteous, you know, in one particular story, if you let that sort of thing start to catch on, that can get extremely dangerous as well.
And I mean, to take it even a step further, whenever we look at, like, on a federal level, we see people being like, these crazy right-wing activists. I mean, Kyle Rittenhouse is a great example of what can happen when things get out of control and you think that you need to go take action into your own hands. I mean, on a federal level, we see a lot of people from the Democratic Party saying right-wing extremists, using that vocabulary, whenever they're talking about someone simple as Ron DeSantis, who is like, yo, I'm going to protect my state and my people as much as I possibly mm-hmm. can. And that means protecting their Second Amendment rights. That means encouraging police, doing the best that we can to give them resources, supplies, the training that they need. That's not saying that there are bad apples in the cart. But when you create this system of mayors and governors and people that rule these states that have a huge say in what goes on, and they are lazy with what they can do, you then in turn create other people that are really like, we are laying down the law. And they wonder why those people are created. It's baffling to me whenever you see those juxtapositions and you see people on the left saying, how does someone that really strictly lays down the law, how are they created? This is the situation. How?
Switching over to Eric Swalwell and Adam Schiff and Ilhan Omar and the continuation of this drama unfolding Kevin McCarthy, not putting them on their committees, not giving them their committee positions, which, by the way, that story also is not been accurately reported in the mainstream media. Kevin McCarthy is not putting Adam Schiff and Eric Swalwell back on the Intelligence Committee. They are available and probably will be on other committees. It's that one committee, because it's so important and because of the reasons that Kevin McCarthy has laid out, that they have disqualified themselves from having access to classified information, secret information that goes to the Intelligence Committee. So, like, this idea of he's banned them from, you know, being on any committees or doing, that's not exactly the truth.
Right.
So the whole story is, context matters, and there's more to that story than what has been focused on by the media. But anyway, yesterday, the three of them were in a press conference, the three of them being Eric Swalwell, Adam Schiff, and Ilhan Omar, and they were responding to McCarthy's decision to not reappoint them to their committees, and said, quote, even though we have said publicly these smears are bringing death threats against us, he continues to do it, which makes us believe that there's intent behind it. But we will not all be quiet. We are not going away. I think he will regret the three of us having more time on our hands. Okay.
What is that?
What is that? They go on to say, but at the end of the day, our mission now is to restore the credibility and integrity of this institution, of which the speaker has so gravely smashed and destroyed.
Mm.
So I don't know what that means. he's going to regret us having more time on our hands. But for Adam Schiff, maybe it means, because that was yesterday, and now today, Adam Schiff has made it official that he has announced his candidacy for the United States Senate.
Mm-hmm.
Moving on from the House of Representatives to the Senate.
You saw that coming.
Running in the seat. Yeah, we've talked about this before. Currently held by Senator Dianne Feinstein. That's the seat that Adam Schiff will now be running for. He said, quote, our democracy is at great risk because GOP leaders care more about power than anything else. Listen, there are plenty of Republican lawmakers there's plenty of politicians, period, that are strictly in it because of the power trip and their egos and are not focused on the right thing or helping people. But for someone like Adam Schiff, for someone in that position in the Democratic Party to say, to criticize the other side, saying because all they care about is power.
It
Adam
is
Schiff,
laughable.
That is the most tone deaf.
Yes.
Pot calling the kettle black. Like, that is the most, like, tough to swallow statement I have ever
Dude
heard.
Still doesn't have.
This guy, he's like Nancy Pelosi. He feeds off of the television cameras and his and the power and being on the intelligence committee and being the chairman of the committee and like being the top, like that is literally all this man cares about.
I mean, that and getting Trump, and he and has not successfully a single time out of all the accusations that he's put forth about Trump, not a single time has anything been successful that he has led to get Trump out. I mean, out of office, impeached, in jail. Nothing that he has done has been successful.
It's funny you say that because his campaign announcement video.
Oh, good Lord.
You know, his sizzle reel.
Oh.
To use it.
The sizzle
an
reel.
Insider term. His sizzle reel, his announcement, his campaign announcement video highlights his record going after Trump, whom he refers to as a, quote, dangerous demagogue. Former House Speaker Nancy Pelosi approached Schiff as a lead impeachment manager for Trump's impeachment trial in 2020, and he led a team of seven House lawmakers who presented evidence to the Senate arguing in favor of convicting Trump on charges of abusing the power of his office and obstructing Congress and removing him from office, and that is all in his big announcement video. So
it's gross.
It's super, super gross. For people that are asking, like, well, what about Dianne Feinstein? Because she's the senator that's sitting in there, and she's a Democrat, like Adam Schiff. It is widely speculated, although she has not announced yet. You know how old she is?
90-something.
89.
Yeah. Oh, 89.
89 years old. Kay. She's the oldest member of in the United States Senate. A Senate term is 6 years long.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so this is the 2024 election. So she'll be nearly 90, or nearly 100, excuse me, if she were to run again and win and go.
Homegirl cannot run again.
Yeah. So it's widely speculated that she is not going to run again. And
yeah. Yeah. That is
the fact that somebody, you know, Adam Schiff is one of the, is up there in the club.
Yeah.
In the cool kids club with Nancy Pelosi and Dianne Feinstein and Chuck Schumer.
They're the establishment Democrats.
So my guess is that Adam Schiff would not make this announcement without knowing that Dianne Feinstein is not going to run again. But again, and you also would think that if you did have that like sort of inner party respect for each other, you would let the elder statesman make their announcement that they are not going to be running again before you jump in the race. But Adam Schiff doesn't care about any of that stuff.
Can I add something to this Adam Schiff story? And I'm sorry if you just said this. I had to go get Quentin really quickly. But
no, you're good.
He made a TikTok. Adam Schiff made a TikTok. And
you don't need to say any more than that.
I happened upon the TikTok. I don't have TikTok, but it's now being shared on Twitter and Facebook.
Oh, no.
He made a TikTok about being kicked off of the Intelligence Committee.
No.
And his big thing was, again, back to the right-wing extremists, his big thing was, do you see what's happening now? I was kicked off. Swalwell kicked off. Omar kicked off. And, and the right-wing extremists, they told you they're playing all along.
Reasons.
And now that they've gotten the power, they've done this to me. And they've done this to my other colleagues.
Yeah.
And to fight the good fight and to be beholden to democracy, true democracy, make sure you donate to my campaign. And it's that's how
it
is.
Give me my money.
Please.
Give me money and give me more power.
Please contribute to my campaign and thank you so much so that we can protect democracy.
Yes.
I have a hard time. I just think it's so bleh. With whether if you are GOP or if you are Democrat, I have just a in my mouth disgust whenever I see a congressperson on TikTok.
Oh.
Or when I see them doing like an Instagram reel or no, your place is not on there.
Listen,
get away from there.
Yeah. And especially when they try to like if they try to use like hip terms.
Absolutely.
Or like, you know, shoot it in a style that's the. You know, the current, like,
I'm relatable.
Yeah.
I'm relatable.
Oh, there is
get
nothing more
off.
Unrelatable
totally
than that. Last quick one here regarding the United States Senate. Florida Senator Rick Scott who was one of the people that was one of the fringe sort of people that were being discussed as possibly running for Republican nomination in 2024 for the presidential election. Florida Senator Rick Scott announced today that he is not going to run for president in 2024. And in fact, he's going to run for re-election to the United States Senate. When asked if he would back Ron DeSantis or Donald Trump, now that he is officially not going to be in the presidential race, he refused to say, saying, quote, "My goal is to have a good working relationship with all Republicans. I don't plan on getting involved in an endorsement in a presidential primary. Think about it. Every Republican who is considering running in a presidential primary, I know. So I am going to focus on my race." So Rick Scott is going to be running for Senate, not president. I don't think he had a chance at winning the presidency anyway, so not a big deal there. But interesting that, you know, we're getting to that time of year where the people that are being are on that speculative list of possibly running for president are, you know, now starting to make their announcements of whether they are in or out.
Does it ever stop anymore?
No, it never stops.
Does it stop anymore? Do we breathe? Do we take a breath and pause anymore with campaigning?
Never stops. We were talking with Rodney Boyd yesterday about this recent lawsuit that Missouri and Texas and 18 other states are suing the Biden administration over their migrant parole program. Well, that lawsuit is up and running and happening. 20 states suing the Biden administration. And now today, another lawsuit has been filed against the Biden administration that include 25 states. At the top of the list, once again, Texas and Missouri, the tag team. Mm-hmm. So we will tell you about that story. I'll also fill you in on that Kimberly Gardner story here in just a moment. So don't go anywhere. You are listening to Colombo and Katie on 101.9 and 94.1 News Talk STL.
Yoski woski, whiskey whiskey.
Speech is alive and well in America.
Sometimes it's hard to know what's real and what isn't.
Right here.
The country is heading in the wrong direction under this president.
We're suffering shortages. America's running out of everything.
News Talk STL. News, analysis, opinion.
What is today? The 26th? Katie, 26th, right, of January?
Yes,
Right. Thank you. It is important because you are running out of time to take advantage of this great offer from Zero Res. Thanks to kids and pets, the Colombo family, our family, has relied on Zero Res to save our home many times. We use them often at our old home. They've already been out to the new house a couple of times. Doesn't matter if it's carpets, tile, rugs, upholstery. Basically, every surface of your home can be Zero Resified, can be cleaned by Zero Res. And right now, to start 2023, if you book a cleaning in the month of January and you mention the Colombo special, you'll get 23% off all services. But you have to book in the month of January, and there's only a handful of days left, so don't wait. This is an incredible offer to start 2023, 23% off all services if you mention the Colombo special when you book your cleaning. But you got to book in the month of January. Don't miss this incredible offer. Call and book now, 314-474-2020. That's 314-474-2020. Or book online at ZeroResSTL.com. Spell it forward or backward. It spells the same, Zero Res.
Win is a financial help show, not just a financial help show. Win, it's Pocket Watching with JT, the caller-driven financial talk show focused on helping you get your money right. Jason Thornton is a certified financial planner licensed in both tax and investments. You get JT's real reaction to all your money and business questions. Plus, you get JT's take on all the latest financial news. This is not just another financial show. Pocket Watching with JT now every Friday night at 8 p.m. on 101.9 94.1 News Talk STL.
Hey, it's Vic. Everyone here at News Talk STL is incredibly grateful for the growth in our business during the first 18 months since we signed on the air. We appreciate the great local businesses like Southern Armory, Rhino Shield, Steph's Pizza, and the Wallner team that have become one of our many advertising partners. If your business is interested in becoming part of the News Talk STL family, simply send an email to info@newstalkstl.com. We have a wide variety of affordable advertising options. And thanks for listening to News Talk STL. Welcome home.
This is News 4 Chief Meteorologist Steve Templeton, and we're proud to be the official winter weather source for News Talk STL. The First Alert weather team is working hard to keep you ahead of the big weather changes and help you plan your day. So stay connected this winter with Channel 4 and News Talk STL.
Listening to Colombo and Katie.
Yeah, if you missed our conversation with Rodney Boyd, the insider's insider of Missouri politics yesterday, make sure that you are subscribed to the Colombo and Katie podcast on your favorite podcast platform so you never miss any of those conversations. We put the show out as a podcast shortly after we get off the air every single day, and we are on basically every podcast platform, so super easy. Just subscribe to the Colombo and Katie podcast. Subscribe to all the shows here at News Talk STL. We all put out our shows as podcasts, so subscribe to the Colombo and Katie podcast. Subscribe to the Colombo and Katie YouTube channel so you never miss anything that happens here on the show. Yesterday, we talked with Rodney about this lawsuit that Missouri, Texas, and 18 other states are suing the Biden administration over their migrant parole program. Today, Biden administration being sued again, this time by 25 states, including Missouri and Texas, which we talked about yesterday, seems to be this tag team that is, it's always Missouri and Texas. Mm-hmm. They're always involved. Sometimes it's just Missouri and Texas. Sometimes they've got 20 or 25 states on their side, but they seem to always be in the middle of this, these lawsuits going after the Biden administration. A group of 25 states filed a federal lawsuit against the Biden administration today, arguing a recent rule allowing retirement plan managers to factor environmental and social issues into investment decisions violated the law. The lawsuit, led by Utah Attorney General Sean Reyes and joined by 24 other states, including Texas and Missouri, challenges a Department of Labor rule unveiled in November and which is set to go in effect on January 30th. The rule would open the door for fiduciaries to factor so-called environment, social, and governance factors into Americans' retirement accounts, an action that the states argued could significantly harm the financial interests of consumers and customers. Listen, we can go into this lawsuit some other time about all the details. What in the world? This one is simple to me. How in the world are you connecting Americans' retirement assets and funds into environmental programs and social justice issues? Like, common sense tells you that those two things have nothing to do with each other. Mm-hmm. They are completely unrelated. So I don't even have to look at the details to know. I have, but I don't need to know that I'm not for this rule. This new Biden administration rule that somehow ties your retirement assets into environmental rules.
Why are we messing around with what people's retirement money?
How are we connect? Talk about federal overreach and how I always talk about how dangerous it is to hand everything over to the federal government. This is why. How are we tying retirement assets into social programs and the environmental programs?
Don't be messing around with people's retirement now.
Those things don't have anything to do with each other.
Everything is being interjected with climate, though. Everything is being interjected with environmental causes, climate crisis. Everything is being that.
Everything is being connected to environmental programs, to social issues, to identity issues. I mean, like, they just, everything is tied into one, all put on one path, one focus that the federal government, that the Biden administration is solely focused on.
Yes.
And it's just like all roads point to that.
It's John Kerry.
Retirement,
he's working his magic.
Retirement assets should not have anything to do with anything that has to do with the environment. How are those two things even in the same sentence? Anyway, like I said, we might be, as this lawsuit develops and this rule that is being challenged and called unconstitutional goes into place, we may get into more of it. But I just, again, I don't think you even need to know the details to know
Bad.
That those two things don't have anything to do with each other. I know you have a story for us.
I do. So the Virginia school board has ousted the superintendent after a six-year-old boy shot his teacher.
This story is...
It's so
tragic,
strange,
horrifying, scary,
so
sad.
The decision follows claims from the injured teacher's attorney that staff members warned the school administrators several times that day that the student, a six-year-old, was armed and making threats against other students. The Newport School's school board in Virginia voted to remove its superintendent following a high-profile incident in which the six-year-old student shot his teacher.
James is five, but he's six in 4 weeks. Just to give you an idea, James, my son, is six, essentially.
I can't. My head
is not
computing.
A loaded gun to school.
And then
that is insane.
And then verbally saying to other kids, threatening them and threatening teachers. In a 5-1 vote, the board members ousted George Parker III and named Michelle Mitchell as the interim superintendent, according to NBC News. The decision follows claims Wednesday from the injured teacher's attorney that the staff warned the school administrators about this several times. Abigail Zwinder, 25, sustained significant injuries on January 6th of this year when the student shot her while she was teaching at the elementary school. The student shot the teacher once, inflicting wounds to her hand and her chest as the bullet flew. On that day, over the course of a few hours, three different times, school administration was warned by concerned teachers and employees that the boy had a gun on him at the school and was threatening people. And they didn't do anything. The school said this. The administration couldn't be bothered, and they even went as far as to say, he has small pockets. How is that possible?
No.
Nobody did anything until this teacher was shot. Luckily enough, she survived.
Yeah.
Thank you, God.
Yeah.
What?
The story is wild.
A six-year-old. And I mean, how does the six-year-old get the gun, bring it to school, threaten people's lives, and nobody does anything until someone's shot?
How does that six-year-old ever go back into a classroom somewhere?
I think the six-year-old's probably going to be going to some kind of institution. I'm almost positive that's what's going to be happening. So sad and devastating. I don't know how to wrap my head around something like
James
that.
James is six.
So sad.
He's less than a month away. He turns six. It's just like...
It puts
think
a
about how
pit
young
in your
that
tummy.
Is.
Yeah. Puts a pit in your tummy
yeah,
thinking about that.
That's kindergarten or first grade. Mm. That story is absolutely, that story is just crazy. We are going to talk to our friend JT from Pocket Watching with JT. Jason Thornton is a certified financial planner and the host of Pocket Watching with JT, which you can hear every Friday night at 8 o'clock right here on News Talk STL. And he also joins us here on Colombo and Katie every Thursday afternoon for a little common sense financial advice. So we are going to get that when we get back. Don't go anywhere. You're listening to Colombo and Katie on 101.9 and 94.1 News Talk STL.
Stream Colombo and Katie at newstalkstl.com.
It's Tony Colombo inviting you to join me for a great show coming to Westport Playhouse for two consecutive nights, February 3rd and 4th. The Retro Nerds present a tribute to Sting and Peter Gabriel. Support local music and come see a great show at the beautiful, newly reopened Westport Playhouse. Enjoy the music of Sting and Peter Gabriel on both Friday and Saturday night, February 3rd and 4th, brought to you by Amicus Wealth Partners. Get more info and your tickets now at westportplayhouse.com.
If you believe Brandon and the supply chain issues are still in crisis, or even if you don't, hurry into Southern Armory, your Second Amendment headquarters, for the best selection of firearms, suppressors, holsters, ammunition, pepper spray, and knives. Browse through our constantly changing inventory, order something special, or have us repair or modify that firearm that you've been putting off. Try our firearms training simulator. See the demo video on our website. Come into Southern Armory, 9901 Watson Road, 1 mile east of 270 and 44, at southernarmory.com. That's southernarmory.com.
It's Proctor spelled like doctor for custom window fabrics and shutters. Upgrade or start from scratch. Either way, Michael is the St. Louis expert. Check him out at ProctorDrapery.com and then call Proctor spelled like doctor for shutters, shades, and draperies.
Proctor Drapery, the best in town. No finer window fashion can be found. Call for an appointment at your home. Spell Proctor like doctor.
The Rob Carter Show.
And he said, you know, be careful that if you say anything negative about Donald Trump, it could hurt the performance of your show. And I say, let the chips fall where they may. I am going to be truthful, regardless, when I get in the airwaves in St. Louis. I was the biggest Trump supporter, stood tall and stood behind the guy until the pandemic. That's when I went, wait 1 minute.
The Rob Carter Show, Sundays at 5 on News Talk STL. Brought to you by Elite Printing and Packaging.
If 2023 is the year that you are thinking about selling your home, do not wait until later in the year to take action. Call the Wallner Home Selling Team at Berkshire Hathaway now, because you don't know how long this window is going to be open. Markets are changing. Things are happening. But it is still a great time to sell your home. I had, you know, my wife and I had incredible results working personally hand in hand with the Wallners, selling our home, our old home, and buying our new home just a little less than a year ago. Now, things have changed since we sold our home, but it is still a great time to do so. But again, you don't know how long that window of opportunity is going to be open. So you need to call St. Louis's number one home selling team now. They sell 15 times more homes per year than your typical home seller for a reason, because they are the best. Call the Wallners now at 314-810-SOLD. 314-810-SOLD. 314-810-SOLD for the Wallner home selling team.
KLGY HD3 Clayton, K270BW Bell Fountain, KNVS Bowling Green.
This is News Talk STL at 101.9, 94.1, and always streaming at newstalkstl.com.
Breaking news this hour from townhall.com. I'm John Scott. Many economists think we're headed into a recession. What does that mean for you? Rita Foley reports.
The widespread view among economists is that it's very likely we'll be in a recession sometime this year. Although there are reasons to think that if a recession does come, it'll be comparatively mild. Still, a recession would mean job losses, though right now employers in many industries are continuing to add jobs. There are signs, though, that consumers are starting to get nervous about spending. Retail sales have dropped for 2 months in a row. Credit card debt is rising, evidence that Americans are having to borrow more to maintain their spending levels. The good news? Those skyrocketing prices for new and used cars are beginning to come down, and price hikes for furniture and clothing, among some other items, are slowing. I'm Rita Foley.
Also at townhall.com, a Nebraska lawmaker calling for greater school choice. Correspondent Bob Agnew.
Republican Congressman Mike Flood says nobody doubts
every parent in America wants to give their child the best education possible.
Trouble is, even in states like his own, with options that include public, private, and home schools,
not everyone has the means to access their option of choice.
He says the solution is to allow school funding to follow the student, not the institution.
When funding for education follows students to the school of their choice, families win.
Flood says his state has no school choice program, something he plans to help change. Bob Agnew, Capitol Hill.
Secretary of State Blinken traveling to the Middle East this weekend. It's his first trip to the region this year. Blinken has scheduled stops in Egypt, Israel, and the West Bank. The trip comes amid an escalation in Israeli-Palestinian violence. The Dow finishing 204 points higher today, and the NASDAQ up nearly 200. More at townhall.com.
How long does it take to tackle a home project? With Angie, you could cross it off your list before this ad is over. Just tell us what you need. Indoor, outdoor, repair, or redesign, and we handle the rest, sending a top pro to get it done. you don't have to lift a finger except to tap the screen or click the mouse. Plus, Angie is free to use. So bring us your next home project and we'll bring it home. Download the app or go to Angie.com. That's A-N-G-I.com to get started.
Relief factor, pain relief that's natural, pain relief that works, and pain relief that attacks the source of the pain. That's the experience of tens of thousands of Americans who are taking Relief Factor right now. See their incredible video endorsements at ReliefFactor.com and then order your three-week quick starter pack for just $19.95. That's less than a dollar a day. Find out if it can work for you like it works for me by ordering your three-week quick starter pack today. ReliefFactor.com, ReliefFactor.com. Be the next success story.
On the international front, diplomatic efforts aimed at limiting Iran's atomic program appear more unlikely than ever.
Rafael Mariano Grossi, the head of the International Atomic Energy Agency, told reporters Iran has enough enriched uranium to build several nuclear weapons if it chooses. While Iran arms Russia in its war on Ukraine, and as unrest shakes the Islamic Republic, tensions with the West are high. However, Grossi believes Iran still has a long road ahead before Iranian nuclear weapons would become a reality.
I'm not saying it is impossible, and I'm not saying we should be complacent or believe that nothing is happening. The trajectory is certainly not a good one.
Whilst Iran hasn't responded to Grossi's comments, the head of the country's civilian nuclear program stated it would welcome a visit by Grossi to the country. I'm Karen Chamas.
Breaking news and analysis at townhall.com. Tesla posting a record net income for the fourth quarter of last year.
The company predicts additional software-related profits will keep its margins higher than any other automaker. The Austin, Texas maker of electric vehicles and solar panels said it made $3.69 billion from October through December. Tesla's profit was 59% more than the same period a year ago.
Correspondent Jeremy House. Revenue for the quarter, $24.32 billion, but that did fall short of the $24.67 billion analysts had expected. American Airlines gave more proof of the recovery in air travel, posting a better-than-expected profit for the fourth quarter, while Southwest Airlines lost money because of massive flight cancellations last month. Southwest reporting a $220 million loss after canceling nearly 17,000 flights in December. More on these stories at townhall.com.
From the Michaels Flooring Outlet Weather Center.
I'm News 4 meteorologist Kristen Cornett with your first alert forecast. Sky's becoming mostly sunny this afternoon with a high of 31, but with winds out of the west gusting as high as 20 miles per hour, wind chills will range between 15 and 20 degrees. Tonight, mostly clear as we drop to 23, and then on Friday, partly to mostly cloudy, a breezy day, wind gust to 30 miles per hour, but warmer, the afternoon high, 48 degrees.
This is what's happening.
That Joe Biden had these documents.
Must deal with the debt limit.
News, analysis, opinion.
Classified information.
We will not comment.
101.9 and 94.1.
What's happening right now?
This is News Talk STL.
You're listening to Colombo and Katie.
Welcome back to Colombo and Katie on 101.9 and 94.1 News Talk STL. Tony Colombo here, of course, with my partner Katie Fitzpatrick. And joining us online, as he does every week, every Thursday at about this time, is our friend Jason Thornton. JT from Pocket Watching with JT, which you can hear every Friday night at 8 o'clock here on News Talk STL, joins us to provide us with a little common sense financial advice. I always feel like a more productive human after having a conversation with JT, because I always feel like I learn exactly that, some common sense financial advice. So JT, always appreciate your time. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing great. Thanks, Tony and Katie. Man, I feel good, man. You get good financial tips from me, I feel like a king of the castle.
Well, you truly are, and I can't recommend Pocket Watching enough as a show to tune into. Of course, You should also be following JT on the Pocket Watching with JT YouTube channel. Over 60,000 YouTube subscribers, which is absolutely incredible. Over 65,000 now, isn't it?
We're over 68,000.
Yeah, buddy.
We're just going to start saying 70,000. We are there. We're there, babe. That is fantastic. That is a credit to you. And I mean, that right there speaks to the credibility of the advice that you've given, that you have been able to build up such a large audience on YouTube. So Pocket Watching happens every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday night on the YouTube channel, Pocket Watching with JT. But Friday, of course, is the Super Show, and it's not only live on YouTube, but it's live here on News Talk STL, and that's Friday night at 8 o'clock. So make sure you are checking that out. I know, JT, we started talking about this a week or so ago, and now for the next couple of months, every week that goes by, we're kind of more and more approaching and getting into the middle of tax season. So I'm sure that that's one of the things that is playing a big role in your conversations right now is people, this is the kind of the time of year where everybody's getting their W-2s and trying to get that process started and figured out. And I would imagine is a very busy time of the year for folks like yourself.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I'm packed, appointment after appointment. The main goal here is for people to understand when it comes to, tax season and dealing with your taxes, I'm a big believer in you need to focus on how is this going to affect your overall financial goals, your long-term financial goals, because far too many people are so focused on, I want to pay the least amount of tax this year, but is that also helping you with your long-term goals? And I say, listen, if you got to pay a little bit more tax this year, but it helps you accomplish your long-term goals, that's what's most important.
Is there any normal, like a very common mistake that people do? Maybe like we talked last week about, like letting your cousin's friend who's supposedly really good at taxes, like handing him over all your stuff and hoping for the best, like, like how that can sometimes backfire and not be maybe the best decision. Are there any other sort of common mistakes that people make as they are preparing their taxes or go about getting this thing done, like that is an easy pitfall to avoid?
Yes. So number one thing I'm going to talk about is people who are self-employed. My self-employed brothers and sisters out there, every year their number one goal is they want to pay as least amount as taxes. But what they're not thinking about is, hey, you're taking on all these deductions and you're lowering your tax liability. But when it comes time for you to want to buy a new house or you want to get new equipment or you're trying to expand your business and people have to actually look at those tax returns to make a judgment on allowing you to borrow money, you end up in a problem. Now, there's other ways that you can lower your tax liability without every year showing a loss. And if your accountant, your advisor, whoever's helping you prepare your tax return, if they're not having that conversation with you, you're having a problem.
Jason, can I ask you something about inflation? Okay, great. Because I know that you help a lot of people with their financial troubles and give them advice on what to do. And inflation is one of those things that is seemingly not disappearing. It's not going away. In fact, it's skyrocketing.
Yeah.
And it's almost being at the debt ceiling. We're almost seeing it hit that debt ceiling. And I'm wondering, when people come to you for advice on what to do, I'm sure there's a lot of panic that ensues whenever we talk about inflation, when they say, how are we going to move around money and make it work? Is that the general sense that's happening still whenever you have some people coming to you asking for advice? Are they mostly concerned of, how am I going to sustain living in my financial living with inflation continuing to skyrocket?
Yeah, I mean, the cost of living should always be something that you talk about, right? Because the cost of living is always going to constantly go up. And you want to make sure that you have a financial plan that adjusts for that inflated cost of living. But first, before you worried about are your investments in the right place to outpace inflation, what about your emergency savings fund?
Yeah.
Because your emergency savings fund is your more direct buffer between you and the direct cost of things going up. You have to have a buffer. If you have that 3 to 6 month emergency savings fund in place, that's going to give you that wiggle room to absorb the extra cost of living and understanding living on a budget is not something that you do only in hard times. You do it throughout your life so that you can have the ability to say, hey, maybe I need to make an adjustment here, a tweak there, so that I can actually, you know, survive during the times where the cost of eggs are like the cost of diamonds, right?
Yeah.
That way you're in a better place. And then when it comes to investments, we've always known in the world of financial planning that if you invest in a well-diversified portfolio of equities, and when I say equities, I'm just talking about stocks, but diversified and like index funds, you're going to outpace inflation for the most part. You will outpace inflation as long as you are a disciplined investor and you are diversified in the market.
JT, what is the theme of tomorrow night's show?
Tomorrow night, it's going to be a bit of a mixed bag because I still have a lot of emails, unanswered emails from the audience that I want to make sure that we answer. We're going to talk about some the worst mistakes that individuals make when trying to, you know, set up their retirement plan. So, you know, it's going to be some fun. So for callers calling in or people who want to go ahead and go to the website and submit their question, go ahead and I'm going to do the best I can to get those answers.
You know, the caller aspect of your show is one of my favorite things because there are so many people, because you've built such a large audience on YouTube, there's a lot of people that call in from our area, but there's also people that call in from all over the country.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, they ask questions that sometimes you don't even think about yourself, that sort of as a listener, you don't think of as yourself, you know, that apply to your everyday life. So of course the conversational aspect of the show is one of my favorite things about the show, but for people that haven't had a chance to tune in yet and are thinking about tuning in tomorrow for the first time and checking out Pocket Watching, as I do each and every week, remind folks, you know, exactly what they can get when they tune in.
Absolutely. It's a call-in financial talk show. It's caller-driven. If you have a personal money question, you can call in. You can get my direct answer. No tap dancing. I'm not trying to sell you anything. I'm going to give you the best financial tip coming from a certified financial planner.
There you go. Follow Pocket Watching with JT on YouTube. And the show is live on YouTube every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And, of course, that Friday show is the Super Show, live also here on News Talk STL. And that's Fridays at 8 p.m. So make sure you are tuned in tomorrow night. JT, as always, thanks for your time this afternoon, and we'll be listening tomorrow.
All right. Thanks, Tony and Katie.
Thank you.
I mentioned this story a little bit earlier. We were talking about people across the country losing confidence in leaders across the country, especially in big cities, especially here in St. Louis, about solving the crime problem. And that is being addressed directly right now here in the state of Missouri. A special prosecutor has been appointed by Governor Mike Parson, would have the exclusive power to prosecute certain violent crimes in the city of St. Louis under a plan Missouri lawmakers are considering this afternoon. Representative Lane Roberts, a Joplin Republican and former director of the Department of Public Safety, said his plan was designed to address a crime problem in St. Louis that has affected the entire state. Roberts told the House Crime Prevention and Public Safety Committee today that he wanted to add a certain homicide case threshold to the bill that would determine when the governor could appoint a special prosecutor. The legislation is the latest attempt by the legislator to bolster criminal prosecutions in St. Louis, reflecting their view that St. Louis Circuit Attorney Kimberly Gardner is not getting the job done. As much as I hate the idea, and this happens on a state level too, we almost always talk about it from a federal aspect, the federal government coming in and trying to usurp local control.
Mm-hmm.
I also don't like it when it happens at the state level, when the governor starts getting involved in city, and you know, like telling, you know, municipalities and cities and everything. And you know, I don't like when something's passed from on high and local people don't get a chance to vote on things. But I actually completely agree with the with Representative Roberts' conclusion here that taking away some of that responsibility from Kimberly Gardner and the city of St. Louis is not taking control away from the local area, because what happens in St. Louis city affects the millions of people living in St. Louis County that have no say in the matter, whether, you know, like in voting for Kimberly Gardner, in St. Charles County, in Jefferson County, in Franklin County, and in other places beyond the state, that they don't have those citizens in the state don't have any say. They can't vote. They can't have their voices heard in, you know, when it comes to Kimberly Gardner and things that happen in the city of St. Louis. And it affects them because the city is the core of the whole thing here. And so when crime in the city is bad, it's bad for all of us. It's bad for all of those counties, all of those areas around the city that I just mentioned.
And
so I don't have a problem with this idea of the governor being able to, if there's a violent crime, a murder, you know, something like that happens in the city of St. Louis, if Kimberly Gardner's not going to go after them, then the governor can appoint a special prosecutor to go after them. I think I'm okay with this. I got to learn a little bit more about it, but anything that we can do to fight crime in the St. Louis area is
I agree.
A good thing.
And I think that we also are looking at the reputation of Kimberly Gardner, and I think that has a lot to do with me being in agreement on what's going on with the governor and him being able to hire someone like that outside of Kim Gardner. She has a horrible reputation of letting people off the hook. She has a horrible reputation of not even listening, answering calls, answering letters that have to do with crime, missing people, guns, violence, cars being broken into. So what can you do? You have to take the next natural step. And I feel like this is a natural step in saying we're going to take away a little bit of your power, not completely, but taking away so that we can have some action happen.
You want to have a little bit of fun here before the show's over?
Sure.
Got some silly stories here.
Okay.
Let's lighten the mood and have a little fun. It's Anton, who, if you're watching on the cameras on the Colombo and Katie YouTube channel or on the News Talk STL Facebook channel or the News Talk STL Rumble channel, you see that there is another silent contributor in the room. Producer Anton is here, and we were talking in the last break, and I said, hey, I have some lighter stories to end the show with if we have time. And Anton was like, it's been a heavy show. I think that's a good idea.
Yup.
So I totally agree with that. So here we go. A guy's fish committed credit card fraud while playing his Nintendo Switch. That is a sentence.
A guy's fish
committed credit card fraud while playing his Nintendo Switch.
How? Wait, the fish was playing the Nintendo Switch or the guy
Correct.
Was playing the Nintendo Switch?
Both.
I am so confused. I am so confused.
Here we go. A few years ago, a YouTuber, just talking about YouTube, one of JT's fellow YouTubers, a YouTuber in Japan rigged up a system that allowed his pet fish to play video games.
Why?
For YouTube views, and apparently it worked. But it worked only for a while because it just backfired after the fish committed credit card fraud. So, this guy in Japan, this YouTuber, wanted to see if his fish could beat the game Pokemon Sapphire using motion tracking software. So he put a grid behind the fishbowl. You know, have you ever seen like one of those like grids with the dots and everything on it? So the dots that corresponded with different buttons. So as the fish swam around and his shadow was cast on this grid, if he hit certain points on the grid, it triggered a button to be hit in the game. And
that's actually really cool.
So here we go. The fish did officially beat Pokemon Sapphire.
That is really cool.
It took him over 3,200 hours compared to the average 30 hours for an average gamer to beat Pokemon Sapphire. But the fish did eventually beat the game. So,
a goldfish.
Apparently this guy, this YouTuber, got a bunch of attention, a bunch of YouTube views with this. So he said, let's do it again. And he set the fish up with Pokemon Scarlet. To see if he could beat that game. But this time, it didn't go as well. Around 1,100 hours into the game froze, and this guy, this YouTuber, was not in the room. He wasn't watching. And when The game froze, but the computer running the game stayed on, and the fish kept swimming, which meant the fish kept pushing buttons. Eventually, the fish managed to open Nintendo's eStore and transferred money from the guy's credit card into his Nintendo account.
That is incredible. I think that is crazy.
So as the fish is still swimming around, the game crashes, the computer stays on, so the fish somehow manages to open up the Nintendo eStore and start transferring money. Now, he only ended up transferring a few dollars. However, if this would happen in the United States, I don't know the laws of Japan. If that would have happened in the United States, somebody other than the actual person transferring money digitally like that is credit card fraud.
That is so the fish, great. That is great.
So the fish committed credit card fraud.
I have to say,
playing Nintendo Switch.
I went into this being like, this is going to be so dumb. But when I think about someone.
You
want
to watch that YouTube channel,
I
don't
do.
You
want
to go to the YouTube channel.
And I have to
and
say.
Watch this fish play Pokemon Scarlet.
This
well,
guy
I don't know if he's playing anymore, but.
Is a smart dude. To set something like that up and to have an experiment like that, I am like, I mean, it's kind of like a low-level thing. But if he's smart enough to do something like that, what else is he capable of doing? I'm actually really intrigued. Not about the goldfish, about the dude.
We should check out the YouTube channel.
I'm
see
down.
What it's all about. All right, one more here. I hate these type of stories. I hate any story that says that broke the world record for whatever.
Sure.
Like it's always ridiculous.
Oh,
it's
yeah.
Like broke the world record for the most eggs balanced on his nose while standing on a chair with one foot. You know, like it's always just something absolutely ridiculous. Well, Pizza Hut, this isn't that ridiculous, but Pizza Hut just broke the world record with a 14,000 square foot pizza. And to me, that's just a giant waste of pizza. 14,000 square foot pizza sets the Guinness Book of World Records. That's a great question. 14,000 square
feet. That's crazy. That's pretty intense.
Yeah. Yeah.
How big is this building?
You know, most homes.
That's a Jeff Allen question.
Most homes are between like 1,000 and 1,500 square feet. So think about
14,000
homes.
That
all next to each other.
Who has the time?
Pizza Hut, because they want to break some non-existent dumb world record. Now, to me, I see that and I'm like, this is a giant waste of pizza and food. And Pizza Hut was thinking ahead, and they said that, you know, they wanted to break the world record and have a little bit of fun with it, but they didn't want anything to go to waste. So they made sure that the 68,000 slices of pizza that go into a 14,000 square foot pizza were used. They were donated. All the pizza was donated to charities in Los Angeles where they made this pizza. But the pizza, if you look at these pictures, this pizza is like on the ground.
They didn't
like,
want to be judged by Tony Colombo.
They're
though.
Given the tree. They're like, you're giving, first of all,
ground
it's been,
pizza.
It's already been on the ground. It's
ground
sitting,
pizza.
And like, how long do you have to eat pizza?
Yeah.
Like, you're donating it to charity, but it's not like you're donating like canned food to charity and they can like have it for
non-perishable.
Yeah,
or something.
You got to eat that. That's got. So, how many charities could it really go to? And how gross was it by the time it had been on the ground, 14,000 square feet.
For the picture.
And,
yeah. That's
all of
a good
that,
point.
And now we're going to give the.
Because we're good like that.
I hate. Am I being a grumpy old man? Or
no,
is this, like,
I agree.
Are these stories like.
Oh, that's totally.
Cringy as can be.
I think your point is so valid to be like, we're okay, so you.
Oh, well, we're going to give the. We gave all the food to charities. Yeah. So like. So
nasty.
What best case scenario?
Pizza.
What do you think? Best case scenario, like 10 hours after this pizza was made and put on the ground, and everybody took their pictures. Like
then we gave it away.
Did they give a piece to somebody?
Because we're good
to
people.
To a homeless person, and like that's just gross.
Oh yeah, I agree.
Like you're not helping. Don't act like you're like.
Don't make a
helping
big
somebody.
A pizza like that either.
Yeah.
But, no way.
But they did, and now they're forever. Solidified in the Guinness Book until Domino's decides they're going to make a 15,000. Could try to get a little publicity.
I do love Pizza
We're talking
Hut.
About it, so I guess they got
I
their...
I do love Pizza Hut.
I guess they got their wish because we're talking about it and no such thing as bad publicity. All right, there's no such thing as a bad radio show here on News Talk STL, and it only gets better from here, folks, because the Tim Jones and Chris Arp Show is coming in. Don't forget to subscribe to the Colombo and Katie podcast. on your favorite podcast platform so you never miss anything that happens on this show. Colombo and Katie back tomorrow at 2 o'clock. Tim Jones and Chris Arp's going to get you through the rest of your Thursday afternoon. Don't go anywhere, and thank you so much for listening to us and supporting us here at 101.9 and 94.1 News Talk STL. Like a
dragonfly. Like us on Facebook at News Talk STL. St. Louis's new choice for conservative talk.
We need change in our country right now.
Live and local.
They clubbed us over the head for 2 years.
Yep, you want corruption? This is how we get corruption.
This is News Talk STL. This is Larry Connor's commentary on News Talk STL.
So, did they mean it to be serious and then, because of the backlash, decided, oh, it's just a joke, a parody? I'm talking about that group in Norway that called Aretha Franklin's 1968 song, "You Make Me Feel Like a Natural Woman." They said, there's no such thing as a natural woman. And that song perpetuates multiple harmful anti-trans stereotypes. Yeah, that's what they put out, this activist group in Norway called the Transcultural Mindfulness Alliance. They said that song is helping inspire acts of harm against transgender women. We want it removed from Spotify and Apple Music immediately. Well, they immediately got hit with a lot of backlash, and that's when they decided to put out, Hey, joke, it's just parody, satire, funny, haha. Not so sure if that's what they intended, but the backlash was real. I mean, one said, so who heard the song and attacked trans people? Name them for $400. Another one said, oh my God, get a life, stop trying to